Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to our inaugural program in our collaboration with the Social Science Research Council. Many of you have been here before, but not all, so I should remind you we're gathered in the homes of Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Franklin's mother, Sarah, who built these twin townhouses in 1908 and gave number 49 on that side to Eleanor and Franklin as a wedding gift. It was here that Franklin and Eleanor raised their family. Franklin recovered from polio, reentered politics, launched his presidential career, and after the election, planned the cabinet, planned the New Deal right here in this house. The houses came to Hunter when Sarah died in 1942, and they were used as a student center until they were closed in disrepair in 1992. Then, thanks to the vision and determination of Hunter President Jennifer Rabb, the houses were renovated and reopened in 2009 as the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute. The Institute has two undergraduate programs, one in public policy, the other in human rights, both with about 100 students. It supports faculty research, offers conferences on leadership, as we will on March 20th, when we take a fresh look at the times of John Lindsay as our mayor. Appropriate, I think, is we have a new mayor and we think about what it takes to be mayor. A principal mission of Roosevelt House is to bring scholars together with policymakers and the general public to talk about important issues of the day. None more important, I think, than the state of democracy both here at home and around the globe. Almost all of us grew up believing that our democratic form of government was the gold standard for the world. But now we have doubts, have anxieties about how well it works and whether the high ideals of our charter documents are consistent with modern realities. I don't need to recite here in detail such evidence as the low approval rating of Congress, now at an historic low, around 14%. I guess it dipped to 9% even last November. Not surprisingly, the world, too, has been taking a critical look at American democracy, and recent studies show actually a marked decline in the, the 20% decrease in constitutional similarities over the last 20 years. People, other countries are looking less and less to us and our Constitution as the model. This trend, no doubt, reflects a growing understanding that one constitutional system doesn't fit all political, cultural, economic, and geographical circumstances. So that's surely one reason. But it also reminds us, I think, that our democratic system needs work. It was designed for a smaller country, largely rural, with a homogeneous population. And as far-sighted as the founders were, they could not have imagined the challenges that industrial growth, ever new technology, a sharply different demographic profile, and more would bring to the system of government they designed, but also made very hard to amend. Franklin Roosevelt thought deeply about these questions. And remember, he led the nation during a time in which the world's faith in democracy was shaken, wavering. Hear his reflection in a 1938 fireside chat. Hear his words. Democracy has disappeared in several other great nations, not because the people of those nations dislike democracy, but because they've grown tired of unemployment and insecurity, of seeing their children hungry while they sat helpless in the face of government confusion and government weakness through lack of leadership in government. We in America know that our democratic institutions can be preserved and made to work. But in order to preserve them, we need to act together to meet the problems of the nation boldly and to prove that the practical operation of democratic government is equal to the task of protecting the security of the people. Those words, 1938, could be said now. In FDR's spirit of optimism and initiative, Roosevelt House is delighted to collaborate with our friends at the SSRC. It was founded to deepen the craft of social science, build the capacity of scholars to accomplish important work, and address major public issues by crossing the frontiers that divide the disciplines and that separate university scholarship from public affairs. Today, as it celebrates its 90th anniversary, the Council continues to nurture new generations of social scientists, foster innovative research, and mobilize knowledge about important issues. And one of these issues, a fundamental one, is the reason we're gathered this evening. The SSRC recently has launched an ambitious program on what it calls Anxieties of Democracy, especially the concern that democratic governments today, notably our own, are finding it difficult to govern effectively in the public interest. Tonight, we will focus on the U.S. We will probe the sources and implications of our country's often deep ideological divisions. And next month, on March 5th, come back and we'll explore why Congress currently has so much difficulty in getting its job done. To help us get started, I'm very glad to introduce Ira Katznelson, the Ruggles Professor of Political Science and History at Columbia. He's president of the Social Science Research Council, and I'm proud to say, a member of the board of Roosevelt House. His recent book, Fear Itself, The New Deal and the Origins of Our Time, takes a deep look at FDR's leadership. We have a lot to learn from FDR, but also from Ira Katznelson. Ira?
Well, thank you so much, Jonathan. Just as I'm delighted to serve on the board here at Roosevelt House, it's a particular treat for me that Jonathan, a dear friend with whom I've worked closely during his new school presidency, serves on the visiting committee of the Social Science Research Council. There are theories of elite interaction, but never mind. The partnership of these two organizations, the two organizations we are privileged to lead, in this series on anxieties of democracy is symptomatic of a wider shared aim to deploy the very best of scholarship and to galvanize leading thinkers to grapple with some of the largest public issues of our time. One of these, for sure, as Jonathan just noted, is this question. How can representative democracies like ours in the United States be strengthened to govern more effectively? The SSRC's new initiative, which we call Anxieties of Democracy, is motivated by a deep concern about whether such core institutions as elections, mass media, political parties, interest groups, social movements, legislatures, the institutions that connect citizens to the political system can capably address large problems like climate change, poverty, inequality, national security in the public interest. Ironically, as democratic institutions have spread throughout the world in the past generation, as the only legitimate system of governance for the great majority of humankind, doubts have arisen about democracy's capacities, not least about its institutions of representation and lawmaking. We thus are drawn to explore not democracy's values, which are so widely shared, but democracy's capacities, not least whether the representative democratic institutions of large, complex societies can allow for productive political participation, for effective government, for popular accountability. Just the other week, on February 5th, we lost one of the greatest political scientists of democracy, Yale's Robert Dahl, who died at the age of 98. 15 years ago, in a book he called On Democracy, Professor Dahl enumerated criteria for an effective democracy, not simply as matters of constitutional formalities or rights, but as a living process. These conditions included the inclusion of all adults and voting equality, standards only recently achieved in the history of the United States, and which still remain under some stress, the chance for citizens to achieve what he called an enlightened understanding of public issues, and the ability through a wide array of institutions to shape the public agenda and achieve effective political participation. At the core of Professor Dahl's vision of democracy as a process lies what another considerable student of democracy, the late Charles Tilly, called, quote, political relations between the state and its citizens that feature broad, equal, protected, and mutually binding consultation. Tonight, we examine a very particular feature of democratic participation and consultation, the role played by sharp ideological divisions that divide members of the public and members of the governing elite from each other. What are the sources of such deep divisions? How do they matter? Do they matter in promoting or inhibiting effective consultation and effective governance? We're keenly fortunate to be joined this evening by two of the country's leading thinkers on the subject of political polarization in the United States. I won't steal time from the remarks we're about to hear from Princeton's Nolan McCarty and Stanford's Nate Persily by elaborating their distinguished scholarly biographies. You can read about those in your program. So let me simply underscore how their work and their writings, which, as I've just said, are noted in the materials on your seats, connect rigorous scholarship and a public voice. We will hear first from Nolan, followed by Nate, each for about 15 minutes. Then the three of us will gather at the table and proceed to a conversation before opening up to a wider discussion. Thank you. Nolan.
Thank you, Ira. Thank you not only for the kind introductory remarks, but also for putting together the SSRC's program on Anxieties of American Democracy. Over the course of about the last 6 months, Ira has convened some of the greatest minds in political and other social sciences to think through the problems associated with contemporary democracies, not just in the U.S., but throughout the world. And somehow I got invited into the room, so I was very happy to participate. But I think there is perhaps a reason why I was asked to into the room, and that is that my research over the past 18 years, covers two of the most important anxieties that we have about American democracy. That is the political polarization of our system, which is the topic of tonight's discussion, but also rising levels of economic inequality. So I want to talk a little bit at the outset about the connection historically between those two factors and why they're both so salient now. But I also want to spend some time just talking about what political scientists know about polarization in the United States. I also had the great honor of chairing a task force of the American Political Science Association to kind of get people together and take an assessment of the scholarship on this, and I'd like to share some of the points of agreement with you to help stimulate some discussion. So let me start with my observations about political polarization and inequality. My arguments really start from a set of empirical findings and puzzles. First, let me talk about the trajectories of partisan polarization in the United States. So my co-authors and I have been able to, using roll call voting data from Congress, compute the positions on a liberal conservative scale for almost every person who served in the United States Senate or the United States House. Then we're able to compute polarization by just simply asking the question, on average, how far apart our Democratic and Republican legislators on these issues as reflected in their voting behavior. So we can go back to the beginning of the Republic. We have, you know, one of the nice things about the United States, we have very good data. We can go back and compute these measures. But let me just talk now about our current party system, the two-party system that emerged out of Reconstruction. So unremarkably almost, given that the end of Reconstruction was occurred 11 years after a civil war, partisan polarization was quite high in the United States. You had deep divisions between the Democratic and Republican parties over a variety of economic and regional issues. And that level of polarization began only to decline, say, around 1920, or with the emergence of the progressive movement, which created kind of opportunities for bipartisan cooperation that transcended parties. But it was really only during the Great Depression, the New Deal, and World War II that deep polarization actually took place in the United States. So we see beginning, say, around 1935, very low levels of partisan conflict in Congress. Lots of bipartisanship, moderate Democrats, moderate Republicans, conservative Democrats, liberal Republicans. We see a period of very great partisan cooperation that lasted throughout the 1970s. But beginning in the 1970s, in particular the late 1970s, polarization in Congress increased almost every term in both the House and the Senate. So that's going to be important when I talk about some of the research on the causes. And in fact, by our measures, again, based on roll call voting, the partisan difference in Congress are larger than any time since Reconstruction. Actually, that's an understatement. They're actually higher than the measures we have for the Reconstruction period. So the divisions between the Democratic and Republican Party, their propensity to cooperate on legislation is really at an all-time low. Okay, so that's the story underlying political polarization. So let me talk about economic inequality. We can measure economic inequality in a variety of ways, thinking about the kind of the distribution of income, the share of income that goes to the top of the income distribution or whatever. But regardless of how we measure it, it follows an almost identical trajectory. It was very high during the Gilded Age that followed Reconstruction, began lowering in the late 1920s, and again became very low, or incomes became very equal following the Great Depression and the New Deal. And then incomes throughout in the United States from about the 1940s to the 1970s were fairly equally distributed. And about the same time that we see polarization increasing, we start to see income inequality rising. So if you go back through the history of American politics, you see a striking coincidence between high levels of partisan polarization and high levels of economic inequality. So I'll come back at the end as to why I think those things are connected. But I think it's important to also take stock of what the other types of arguments that people have considered about polarization. Because in part, one of the things that people have argued is that, you know, polarization is just a kind of reflection of kind of malfunctioning electoral systems or gerrymandering or partisan primaries. But if you take my view that it's kind of deep-seated and structural, those things are going to not matter very much. Okay, so let me talk about what political scientists think we know. And this is not just what I think. This is what my committee was able to more or less agree upon. Okay. So I mentioned my evidence about congressional roll call voting. But if you look at a variety of measures of polarization and also qualitative historical evidence, most political scientists date the roots of polarization in the mid-1970s. So they go back about 40 years. If you look at the quantitative measures, the increase has been almost monotonic. And almost every year there's an increase in the divisions between the parties that are almost unrelated to the events of those periods. So this fact cast doubt on some of the explanations that are often given that polarization is a result of contemporary events, such as the Clinton impeachment in the late 1990s, the disputed 2000 presidential election, the election of Barack Obama, the emergence of the Tea Party. It's a long, the most important thing to take away from this is that it's a long-term trend. The second thing is that, as I said at the onset, the divisions are just as true of the Senate as they are of the House of Representatives. So if we're going to look for the reasons for political polarization, congressional dysfunction, we can't just simply look at one chamber and not the other. And that fact alone, I think, suggests that polarization is really a function of long-term social trends, such as income inequality, but also the post-civil rights realignment of Southern politics. And we can come back to how those things might be related. A second point, perhaps more controversial, the evidence points to a major partisan asymmetry in polarization. There's a widespread belief that I think is propagated to some extent by lazy journalism that both political parties have moved to the extreme. And so the reason we see deeper divisions in Congress is because the Republican Party has moved to the right and the Democratic Party has moved to the left. That's just not what the evidence shows. It's not to say that it was wrong for the Republican Party to move to the right, but that's what happened. Since the 1970s, each cohort of new Republican legislators has taken more conservative positions than the previous cohort that entered Congress 2 years before, and that's almost without exception. That is not true of the Democratic Party. Some new cohorts of Democratic freshmen are more liberal than the sophomores. Some are more conservative. There's no pattern. The one exception is that the increase in the representation of African Americans and Latinos in Congress has shifted the Democratic Party somewhat to the left. But once you take that factor into account, most of the movement is within the Republican Party. The next important issue is that the increase in polarization has done what political scientists call reduce the dimensionality of conflict. So in the 1950s and 1960s, politics was kind of multidimensional. There'd be different coalitions on different types of issues. So some coalitions would be bipartisan, some would be partisan, some would reflect the extremes of both parties, depending on whether it was racial issues or agriculture or defense. One of the things about the polarization of the past 40 years is things have become much more unidimensional. It's the same coalitions, the same every time, whether it's the minimum wage or defense or voting on food stamps. It tends to pit conservative Republicans against liberal Democrats, and so that's an important thing to keep in mind, that you know these divisions are issue after issue, and they're entrenched. Another issue that we encounter is to think about the extent to which congressional polarization, if you will, is just simply a reflection of polarization in society. Should we blame this on the voters? Do we have more extreme voters? Are there more conservative voters? Are there more liberal voters? There's quite a bit of controversy within political science to the extent to which voters have become more extreme. But almost no political scientist thinks that voter polarization can completely account for congressional polarization. Voters have probably polarized a little bit, but the parties in Congress have polarized a lot more. There's one exception to this claim, and that is that voters seem to be much more sorted into their political parties. So if you're a liberal voter, you're much more likely to identify with the Democratic Party than you were a generation ago. If you're a conservative voter, you're much more likely to identify with the Republican Party than you were a generation ago. And it follows issue by issue by issue. And the same lower dimensionality that voter preferences on food stamps and abortion and defense all tend to cluster together much more than they did before. And that probably does contribute to the polarization in Congress, but it can't explain all of it. Fourth, and this may be surprising, There is a consensus, I think, or emerging consensus among political scientists that features of our electoral system, such as political gerrymandering and the use of partisan nomination primaries, are not likely to be the most important causes of polarization. There may be some effect, but that's not the entire story. That the House and the Senate have polarized in tandem suggests that partisan districting can't be an important part of the story. I like to tell the joke that the last time the Senate was gerrymandered was when the Dakotas were split into two states so the Republicans could get four new senators. So that's the last time. This, obviously, the Senate is not gerrymandered. Similarly, scholars have found that there's really not an effect of the use of partisan primaries. Kind of extreme activist groups are able to manipulate any type of primary system, and so whether or not it's a closed primary system where only partisans can vote, or an open one with a more diverse electorate, the role of outside groups kind of undermines any relationship. There is some evidence, however, that increasing reliance on extreme individual campaign contributors is an important factor. Finally, let me talk about the consequences. Clearly, polarization in Congress derives both from sincere ideological differences about policy means and ends, but also strategic behavior to exploit these differences to win elections. The combination of the high ideological stakes and the intense competition for party control in national government has all but eliminated any incentives for bipartisan cooperation on important national problems. Consequently, the main effect of polarization has been the reduced congressional capacity to govern. Congress has been less productive in legislation, more prone to delays in appropriating funds, increasingly slow in handling executive and judicial appointments. While it's hard to quantify, there's considerable evidence that there's been a decline in the quality of legislative deliberation and legislative output. But I think a kind of important concern for the anxieties of democracy is the concern that as Congress has lost the ability to govern, that the locus of power is shifted to less democratic institutions, such as the executive branch and to the judiciary. It's a natural response to Congress's inability to govern, but it may be a lamentable one in the long run. Okay. So that's kind of a summary of kind of the highlights of political science thinking about polarization. So let me come back to my arguments about polarization and inequality and why these two important anxieties tend to go together. Very much, I think, consistent with these consensus views. The first is that inequality produces polarization. Clearly, our party system has long been based, at least in part, on divisions based on class, income, and wealth. And just the massive increase in inequality we've seen over the past two generations has exacerbated these cleavages and has led to important divergence in preferences over the role of markets and government among our elected officials. And you don't have to go too far from reading, you know, what was discussed in Congress today or yesterday or the week before to see the salience of these fundamental debates about the role of markets and governments, which I think has been exacerbated by the increased inequality and the divergent preferences across different income groups. But I think more importantly, that the effects of polarization is not merely that it created such a debate about the relative importance of markets and governments. Its main effect with our society has been to emasculate government and to make it ineffective. And as we've seen over the course of the past two generations, the American political system has dealt with the challenges of globalization and trade and changing demographics, all of the things that lead to income inequality, much differently than other Western democracies. And I think that's in large part because of the ways in which our political dysfunction, political polarization, has made governance so difficult in the contemporary United States. Okay, so let me stop there.
Thank you, Ira. Thank you to the Roosevelt House. Thank you to my friends in New York who've come here today. I just moved only 6 months ago from New York to California. Some say it's as a result of the fact that I drew the congressional districts here and had to get out of town. But we can talk about that in the discussion period. I'm going to talk about the sort of conceptualizing polarization and then talk about the different types of solutions that are often put forward. And then if I have time, I'll talk a little bit about my experience serving as the research director of the President's Commission on Election Administration, where we, I think, at least for the time being, it's been a successful bipartisan enterprise and maybe one that could be replicated. I often say that I'm a law professor, a political scientist, and a practitioner in this area. And so you can tell when I'm a law professor because I have opinions without data. You can tell when I'm a political scientist because I have data without opinions. And I'm a practitioner, well, my opinions will depend on who I'm working for. But I also, in thinking about political polarization, I sort of analogize those of us who work in this area to sort of anthropologists who study human cannibalism, which is at a certain stage you have to displace normal human impulses of disgust and revulsion and replace them with fascination and curiosity. And so in that spirit, let me just talk about how we sort of define polarization, how we think about it, and then move on to the possible solutions. I'll reiterate a lot of what Nolan has said, and I encourage you to, I mean, Nolan's books on this are really the at the forefront of the study of polarization in Congress, and so I commend them to you. Mine will come out later this year, you know, we'll see. You could also wait for the movie. But when we always talk about polarization, we usually mean many different things at the same time. People talk about the Tea Party, they talk about polarization, they point to Ted Cruz, they're looking at the government shutdown, talking about gerrymandering, talking about Fox News, the meanness of people toward each other. All of these things sort of get labeled with polarization, and I sort of think it's important for us to isolate the different facets of the polarization problem so that we can assess whether proposed solutions are actually going to make a dent in this multifaceted problem. So the way I think about conceiving of polarization is thinking about three different dimensions. The first, which Nolan described, is the ideological convergence and divergence of the parties, which is to say the Democrats are more like Democrats than they've been for 100 years and Republicans are more like Republicans, and that the space between them ideologically is farther apart than it's been for over a century or more. So that's one feature of polarization. The second is gridlock, or the obstacles to policymaking. Now, it is not necessarily the case that the first form of polarization should lead to the second. But as Nolan was describing, the dysfunction in our political institutions has coincided with this rise in what we would call parliamentary style parties in the US. So you've got ideological convergence to divergence, you've got the gridlock problem, and then you have the problem of incivility, right, which is not necessarily captured by those first two, and could extend beyond the formal institutions of government to things like the media, the internet, the rise of communications technologies, and how that has coarsened our discourse. So each one of those, some of those problems may be more amenable to solutions than others, but I think it's important to try to isolate what we're talking about when we're talking about polarization. So first, I think Nolan gave a good tour through the literature on ideological convergence and divergence. Let me just say that this question as to whether the mass is as polarized as the elites is an ongoing debate among political scientists. There's no question of two facts, right? First, that the elites are more polarized than the mass. And it's also true that the elites and the mass public are more polarized than they have been historically, right? And so it does depend a little bit on what issue you look at in terms of how you're defining polarization. So Mo Fiorina, for example, a political scientist at Stanford, will often point to attitudes on abortion, guns, and now moving on issues with gay rights and say, well, there's more of a bell-shaped distribution of opinion on the mass public than there is at the elite level. But on almost all the issues that Congress confronts, that Nolan described, if you ask those questions to the mass public, you will get a pretty polarized distribution, and increasingly so than it has been for the last 20, 30, 40 years, right? And so while there is this gap between the representatives and the mass public, there's certainly polarization occurring in both settings. Secondly, in thinking about gridlock, not only, the problem of these parliamentary style parties, right, is exacerbated by the fact that we have a separation of powers system. It used to be the case that political scientists in the United States lamented the fact that you couldn't tell a Democrat from a Republican. That was the problem 40 years ago. We even developed something at the American Political Science Association, a committee for responsible party government, right? Said, oh gosh, if we were only like Britain, right? And now we've got parties, whether they're responsible or not, you can decide. But the point being that they're more different from each other, and you can identify and in theory hold them accountable if they were governing all three branches of government, right? But parliamentary parties are not suited to a separation of power system such as we have. And so, of course, the budget debates and the budget, the default crises that we've had over the last year are the most obvious example of this. But it extends beyond the formal constitutional obstacles to policymaking and goes even further to the what I would call sort of the extra constitutional norms that have constrained American politics that really hadn't been used until the current period. So let me just give you a few examples. So while it's hard enough to pass legislation because you have to get both the House and the Senate to agree and have the president sign, beyond that, the increasing use of the filibuster, right, which everyone has recognized, at least until it's the filibuster reform this year, has made it impossible in recent years to get anything through the Senate unless you have 60 votes. Right? The use of senatorial holds in order to prevent even the most sort of low-level executive appointments has also obviously been on the increase. Nolan mentioned the impeachment, and I would, even though it's certainly true that you can't say that the impeachment is the beginning of American polarization in the party system, it also erased a norm as to what types of crimes and misdemeanors would be impeachable offenses. And these types of actions in the Congress have then led to, in a kind of Newtonian way, to opposite reactions in the executive branch. So the use of signing statements by the president in order to sort of have quasi legislative interpretations in as he executes policy. The decision by Obama not to enforce certain laws like DOMA, right? Also another way of sort of getting around inability to get action through the Congress. And even at the state level, when confronted with the possibility that certain norm-breaking legislation was going forward, you see a rise in the number of times that legislators will leave in order to prevent a quorum from passing legislation in the states. Now, those are examples of obstacles to policymaking, but there's another norm that has been eroded, and this is sort of the area I work in most directly, which is the alteration of the rules of democracy. So that while it's true gerrymandering is as old as Eldridge Gerry, which is to say over 200 years, mid-decade gerrymanders like we saw in Texas breaks a norm that had sort of governed American politics when it came to the redistricting process. And while the recall had always been there, right, the recalls that have actually been growing in a geometric pace since the California recall, where Governor Schwarzenegger took office, is unprecedented. We had over 100 recalls in the 2012 election, both at the state and the local level. And so you see the NRA using the recalls in Colorado. You see Democrats using it in Wisconsin and elsewhere. And then while we've had obviously a rich history of disenfranchisement in the United States, the use of certain monkeying with the rules in terms of who has access to the ballot for partisan reasons in recent years is also, I think, a breaking of this norm. So you have ideological convergence and divergence, you have gridlock, and then what about this decline in civility? Now this is the hardest thing to measure and I think the hardest thing to solve, but I'll just throw it at you, which is that when people talk about polarization, often they're talking about the rhetoric that's being used by political elites, not just in government, but outside. So whether it's Rush Limbaugh or Fox News or MSNBC, or in particular, the internet, that the new technologies of communication are facilitating a kind of polarizing rhetoric that maybe historically hadn't been the case. I'm not positive that's true, you know, whether you go back to Father Coughlin or who else, but it's certainly the case that the availability of anonymity or the facilitation of anonymous speech through the internet and the kind of instant echo chambers that develop as a result of the new technologies, I think has an exacerbating effect. Now let me talk about solutions. So as Nolan said, there is a school of thought that says good government reforms will be the solution to our polarization, particularly pointing to redistricting, changes in primaries, and also in the campaign finance system. And Nolan and I are of the same school of thought. I guess we're the bad government school. If they're the good, they're the good government reformers, we're the bad government reformers. So one argument, and California has been the great laboratory on this. You try to move toward a nonpartisan redistricting commission in order to create a greater number of competitive districts. Doesn't turn out that while you might end up getting more competitive districts, it doesn't turn out that the elites that who get represented end up being more or less conservative or liberal than the ones who they replaced. Same with the top two primary that we passed there, which is a form of a primary system where it's sort of the same way you used to do student council elections in high school. The top two people go on, whether they're two Democrats, two Republicans, and then you have a runoff. There's no evidence that that makes a big difference. On campaign finance, the good government reform is often to try and clamp down contributions and to try to prevent money from coming into the system. But as you know, the Supreme Court has been pretty clear as to the ability of pretty much anyone to spend as much money as they want advocating for or against particular candidates. But there is, let me sort of give voice to the bad government view on this. If you're of the view that the problem with respect to polarization is not so much trying to generate the election of moderates, but it's about reining in the extremes, that maybe the answer is to strengthen the political parties, not to weaken them, right? And so that John Boehner is actually the solution, not the problem here. And that the point here is that the parties are weaker electorally than they have been in generations. So that the choice right now is whether you make the parties richer participants in the electoral system so that they can rein in the extremes, so that they can rein in the Koch brothers. Or do you let the extremes dominate who's going to be winning in these primary elections? So there's a set of reforms. Public funding of the parties is one of them, but even beyond that, even returning to a system where you could have increased contribution limits to political parties is one of the chief sort of bad government ideas that I think gets floated out there. But even beyond that, emboldening the leadership of the parties in order to clamp down on party challengers, to have a greater role in party nomination procedures, and even to return to days when the party leaders were able to have other tools that they could use, whether they were earmarks or other kinds of procedures in order to get the extremists in the party on board. So all of those are the types of, I think that's the debate that we're seeing when people talk about reforms to address polarization. It's between the good government and the bad government folks. Let me end with just my experience with working with the Presidential Commission on Election Administration. The Presidential Commission was established by President Obama after the 2012 election when he saw voters waiting in line in Florida and said, we have to fix that. The chairs of the commission were Barack Obama's White House counsel, Bob Bauer, who was also his lawyer for two election cycles, and Ben Ginsburg, who was Mitt Romney's lawyer as well as George W. Bush's lawyer. And then an array of people from private industry and election officials were on the commission as well. And one of the things that I think was successful about this commission was that it didn't have any elected officials on it, which I think facilitated compromise and a focus on expertise. It was not filled with moderates. Now, the inclination, I think, is for people to think, well, to achieve bipartisan compromise, you've got to get reasonable people in the middle. Bob Bauer and Ben Ginsburg are hardcore partisans who will describe themselves as partisan hacks. And what we did was we, with their leadership, and we focused really from the bottom up and looking at the state and local officials instead of talking to the federal or congressional folks. And the recommendations that came out of the commission were quite technocratic, but also dealt with big issues like early voting, online voter registration, issues dealing with voting technology, and the like. And so I think that the sort of ingredients for the success of the commission were, again, that partisans were involved, but they weren't elected partisans, that we worked really with the local officials. And the other thing that we were constrained in doing, but I think is critical to success for these bipartisan efforts, is to be able to have a space for deliberation that isn't public. Now, we couldn't do that because the Federal Advisory Commission Act, otherwise known as FACA. But so that fell to me as the research director to be the conduit for each one of the commissioners in order to craft the report. But it was taking it out of the limelight and providing a safe space for partisan deliberation on what should have been maybe the most confrontational of political issues, which is the design of the electoral system, which I think might have some promise for the future.
First, thank you both so much for a rich and illuminating tableau and presentation of a tableau of issues to consider. I'd like to start the conversation with a fairly broad question. In a democracy, when is there too little and when is there too much ideological division?
I mean, it's pretty clear that we want to have, in a democracy, you want to have a system of representation in which people's preferences get reflected in the governing institutions. So we don't want to artificially manufacture consensus in such a way that we, going back to the 1950s and 60s, where we were concerned that there were no difference between Democrats and Republicans, that's clearly too little. You have to have, in a democracy, you have to have robust debate, you have to have political competition, you have to have parties that provide alternatives to the party in power, and so on. I think the central problem for us is that our constitutional system is not well suited for a situation of extreme polarization. At some point, despite the heterogeneity in society, the diversity of opinions, we have to reach collective decisions. And so we need a set of institutions that kind of match the challenge of reaching agreement in a very heterogeneous and divided society. So I think we are at the point which the polarization is outstripped our capacity to govern. And that's the point in which I think it becomes too much.
Well, you mentioned before my old professor, Bob Dahl, and the school of thought that he was thought to be associated with was the pluralist school of political science. Now, much of that theory of political science was to take on those who said, well, it's all about the economic power structure and in cities and elsewhere that are determining politics. So he's really going after the Marxists to a certain extent. But there was also a correlative argument about the party system, which is about its ability to represent the heterogeneity in the US, right? And so that if you have weak parties, which is to say not as ideologically defined as we have them today, but ambiguous enough so that each interest group can find a place in it, then that is conducive to the kind of multidimensionality that Nolan was talking about in his prepared remarks. But the problem is when on every political issue you have this predictable alignment with all Democrats and all Republicans opposing each other, that then the separation of power system is not meant for it. Now, at the same time, it's not as if we have levels of political disagreement that you have in continental Europe, right? We don't have a communist party or a fascist party akin to what they have there. Nevertheless, the when you look at the ability of government to function, it's simply the unifying characteristic of the ideological divergence and convergence I was talking about, which is making policymaking impossible under our constitutional system.
Nate, you just mentioned in passing the relationship of interest groups and political parties. Nolan and I have been involved as examiners and as mentors to a young political, very talented political scientist now at Boston University named Kate Krimmel, who's done a 50, 60 year look at the relationship between interest groups and parties and finds something of the following. This will be too crude a summary of a very rich body of work. If you were to look back to the 1940s and 50s, you would find it often hard to know which party was the preferred party of a given interest group. Included early feminist attempts to pass, say, an ERA, tried to influence both Republicans and Democrats. Indeed, political scientists writing when Bob Dahl was telling us what the system looked like, other colleagues like V.O. Key Jr. and David Truman, were writing texts that argued that interest groups had an interest in not being too close to any one party because you wouldn't know who would be in power the next time around. And what Krimmel has shown is that over the decades, there's become a growing identity and concentration of some groups, think NRA, for example, with one party, and other groups, say pro-choice on abortion question, in another party, so much so that they become almost impossible to separate out. Now, what happened to the logic that made interest groups and even social movements careful, think of the civil rights movement, careful about being too closely identified with one party or the other, so that we've moved today to a circumstance which must reinforce polarization of the groups that generate the interest and participation of citizens in politics that sort them so effectively into one party or another based on their positions in the interest group world. I don't know, Nate, do you want to start on this one?
So I have an answer which will prove my bona fides as one of the bad government types. But I think if you look back to this earlier period, parties were very autonomous organizations, and they were autonomous because they weren't interest groups. They were groups of politicians who wanted to get elected. They had patronage operations. They were organizations that existed to win elections, and they used the levers of power primarily to win elections, not to seek public policy goals per se. They would present positions on issues in order to get reelected, but they weren't ideological in the same thing. I think, and perhaps, and this would be overstated, but because of the good government types, there was a real attempt over the course of the last century to weaken that traditional form of political party, to destroy its underpinnings in terms of patronage, to destroy its underpinnings in terms of the career ladders that take you from local politics into national politics. And the political parties became more or less hollow shells which became available for interest groups to capture and dominate. So in a period in which parties are autonomous organizations, yes, interest groups want to keep a distance because they worry about electorally minded politicians changing positions or losing elections. But in a world which political parties became hollow shells, it makes much more sense for outside interest groups to try to dominate them, both internally through the structures, but also through primary elections. So one of the great good government reforms of the past 45 years was the McGovern-Fraser Commission, which basically destroyed the traditional Democratic Party and replaced it by a set of interest groups. So there's my bad government bona fides.
Let me say one thing on this point, which is, and this is looking to the future, if you had to project out what types of issues might scramble the parties a little bit, and so that the interest groups might play both sides, the national security and surveillance state issues are the ones that I think, you know, you're seeing some unpredictable coalitions that are forming in the wake of all the Snowden and other revelations. And so we'll see how that shakes out and whether the more the libertarian right and the ACLU left will sort of be coalescing. Let me say one other point on this, which also deepens the argument about how everything has a liberal or conservative or Republican or Democratic valence at this point, which is that it's also true of every institution of government right now, which is to say, you look at something like, obviously, the EPA, which is started by Nixon, right, is now, has a political valence to it. Each one of the agencies, even the Fed right now, which might have been seen as the paradigmatic sort of nonpartisan institution, the Census Bureau, now has a political valence to it, which it hadn't had historically. And that it's hard to see how that retreat would happen, where it would sort of lose the kind of cast that's been put on it by contemporary politics.
So the portrait you began with, Nolan, of this picture of a post-Reconstruction high polarization dipping in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and then rising since the 70s. Are we to think then of the period of comparatively low polarization as the great exception to what is ordinary and normal in American life? And if so, would that reduce our sense of anxiety? Or are we now faced with something even more dramatic and intense, in part for reasons of the new media, in part for reasons of the way interest groups line up, in part for any other reasons? So what kind of moment are we in terms of the depth of anxieties we should realistically feel, not just emotionally feel? Many of us turn on the news on a daily basis and in despair. But where are we from your long historical perspective, the one you talked about, Noel?
Let me preface this remark with, I just flew back on Sunday from Egypt, and so when I think about anxieties of democracy, it's important to put it into context. They're so anxious about democracy, they may not see it again for another 20 years. So it's important to keep in mind that that comparative perspective. But I take the premise of the question to be, what is the normal state of American politics? Is it this period of low polarization, bipartisanship that emerged in the 1930s and persisted through the 1960s? Or is it the high levels of polarization that we witnessed during the Gilded Age and during our contemporary Gilded Age? And I think I regret, well, not completely regretfully say, but somewhat regretfully say that it's the polarized period that we're living in now. There is so much that's exceptional about the period from the 1930s to the 1970s, that we're unlikely to relive it and probably wouldn't want to relive it. So consider several factors. One, immigration from outside of Western and Northern Europe was basically shut down in the 1920s and not restored until the 1960s. So the United States was a very ethnically homogeneous population throughout this period, in a way that we don't, you know, perhaps even the most nativist of politicians can't even imagine trying to restore. Second, we lived through a Great Depression and a world war, which had, I think, major impacts on the way in which the political system was constructed. We had a Cold War in which anti-communism provided some of the basis for bipartisan cooperation. And we had the Jim Crow system in the South, which kept a set of issues off the agenda and allowed for cooperation among Southern Democrats and Northern Democrats, as well as cross-party cooperation between Southern Democrats and Republicans. We're unlikely to see any of those factors completely restored. So I think it's an open question as to what sorts of issues or bridges can kind of build back at least some areas of bipartisan cooperation. The national security state's one possibility. There are often glimmers of bipartisanship in education policy. But it's really hard to see the sorts of things that would lead to the restoration of the bipartisanship of the mid-20th century.
And so I think that we need to think harder about how to live in such a system rather than trying to turn it back to something that was pretty artificial to start with.
I agree with that, but let me just focus on the point about the South, which is that, you know, the big story in terms of the ideological distance between the parties is that white Democrats are now Republicans. And so that huge shift where you did not have a viable Republican Party in the South for, you know, over 100 years, then their replacement by white Republicans is the big change. And now, if you look at the Congressional Caucus of the Democrats in the Deep South, I think there are only six white Democrats left. Look at the data on that. And so the Southern realignment is sort of the biggest part of this story, I think. But this also goes to the question of how you define polarization. So are we more or less polarized now than we were in the 1960s when freedom riders were going through the South and there was violence directed toward African Americans? Now, we can make the arguments about roll call votes, but it depends on what you're focusing on as to the aspect of polarization. Is it when you have issues that are suppressed, like racial equality, because of the party system, it doesn't mean that there aren't differences of opinion that are extremely intense, right? But it's just that the formal political system is only dealing with certain types of issues at the elite level. Now, the party system is dealing with maybe more issues and they're taking a partisan valence that they didn't have previously.
There are logically four kinds of votes members of Congress can make. They can make votes that cross party lines. They can vote in a polarized party way. But they also can vote, members of Congress can vote by defecting from their party and joining the other party. You wouldn't call it bipartisanship in the sense of having a broad consensus, but a particular group, say the Southern Democrats on labor questions in the 1940s, voted with Republicans while they voted with other Democrats on most other issues for a very particular reason. They thought labor unions were a threat to the racial order. So that's a defection strategy. And a fourth kind of vote would be highly particularistic constituency or region-based voting. Westerners might not vote the same way as every other region on some issues, or New Englanders. In looking at the current array of issues that face the country, and looking, projecting 5, 10, 15, 20 years ahead, and trying to think of the of polarization in part as the new normal, but also not as a fixed, static situation of the what we have today is likely to exist exactly this way in 20 years, can we think of issues that might create genuine bipartisanship, defection from one party to the other on a very focused small set of issues, important issues, perhaps like issues of secrecy or surveillance of citizens by a national security state? Can we think of the country in regional terms as where one or another part of the country might develop highly distinctive interests, whether about trade or other kinds of issues? How would we think about potential lines of movement in a more fine-grained way than just the words bipartisan or polarized?
So let me give you some potential examples. So one of the things that's become, I think, very prominent within both parties is sort of a nascent populist movement. So you see this within the Democratic Party I'm blanking on her name, Elizabeth Warren, the senator from Massachusetts, Sherrod Brown, senator from Ohio. But you also see to some extent within the Republican Party, even an economic populist, concern about, you know, finance, Wall Street, big banks, et cetera. So I follow this somewhat closely. I've recently written a book on the politics of financial crisis. You do see some nascent you know, bipartisanship in the areas of financial regulation. So some of you may know to recall that there is a bill in the Senate called the New Glass-Steagall, basically to separate commercial investment banks and insurance. Once again, its sponsors are John McCain and Elizabeth Warren. So there are issues like that that potentially, in addition to the national security stuff, which could lead to real and substantial bipartisanship. John Huntsman was one of the first people, politicians of either party, to come out in favor of breaking up the big banks. So that is one issue in which there's some glimmers of bipartisanship, but we'll see how much that's sustained.
You know, I'm a little bit surprised that there isn't more of what Nolan's describing. So if you look at the reaction to Dodd-Frank and how it has now been, I think it's Republican orthodoxy pretty much that is a bill that, with a law that's doing more harm than good. And so while you will see, and you'll see this in the rhetoric of the Tea Party movement also, arguments about Wall Street and corporations and big banks, I don't see it as much as I would have expected in the wake of such a defining event as a financial crisis, to see the more cross-cutting cleavages than there are today. The issue that I would see besides the surveillance one I mentioned before is, so if because of global warming, we basically are gonna be losing coastlines, right? And it's gonna have huge effects throughout the country, you could see that as having a realigning effect, maybe the political parties, and sort of create both regional and other types of interests that would shake up the party system. And then a foreign policy crisis could do it as well, leave aside national security state, but if there's another war or something like that.
Now, for those of us, probably all of us in the room, interested in, not just in the mechanics of how democracy is working, though we may be anxious about those, or about polarization, the degree of distance between the parties. But those of us who care about the capacity of government to identify and solve, or at least address, big public issues, should we be more concerned about polarization, or more concerned about a silencing or a limiting of the spectrum of possibilities? This may sound like somebody to the left of politics, perhaps I am. But the movement in American life in the last 20, 30 years has not just been a movement that's divided the parties from each other, but there's been a very significant shift in the median position of lawmakers and voters from the center, or sometimes even the center left during the Great Society period, to center right to right. So the kind of proposal that the Heritage Foundation made, or the governor of Massachusetts instituted for healthcare, which was seen as a right center alternative to Hillary care, is now the left wing of American politics. EPA and environmental protection, OSHA and workplace safety, just to take two other issues, or parts of affirmative action, which were supported by both parties in the Nixon years, today have shifted, the center of gravity of those issues has shifted rightward. Do we have, therefore, a smaller spectrum of possibilities from which to consider policy than we had 15, 20, and 25 years ago? And is that connected or not connected to the question of polarization?
I guess part of the question is whether, when we talk about the spectrum of possibilities, if it's sort of endogenous, that we're thinking about it in terms of what's realistically possible, given what's possible in elite circles. So you're not going to have, we talked earlier about cap and trade with environmental policy, right? That was seen as a kind of conservative approach to dealing with global warming and other pollution. And now it's seen as a left-wing idea. But it is a market-centered reform, right? And I sort of feel like at least the conversation has put certain types of policies off the table when it comes to big government, right? And so that big cleavage in American politics, which has been since the founding, does limit the possible spectrum of ideas so that you're not going to get a return to the New Deal.
So I think the 1970s represents a real kind of intellectual crisis for questions about the role of markets in government. It was seen, rightly or wrongly, seen as kind of a failure of a particular type of governance model, the Keynesian welfare state. And so there was an attempt, both kind of a natural progression to think of market alternatives as plausible replacements, but also a concerted campaign to kind of promote the idea of markets as an alternative to status solutions. So I do think the polarization goes hand in hand with this this movement away, the skepticism about status solutions in favor of market solutions.
Can I just interrupt? Sure. Do you think that also might be outside the U.S. as well, though? I mean, I think that there is at least a focus. If you're comparing it to the 1950s and 60s, right, that I don't think the U.S. is alone in sort of moving toward more sort of market alternatives in these areas.
No, I don't think that's right. I mean, if anything, the British were somewhat ahead with Thatcherism.
We need to open up, and I'd like to open up to the floor. I just want to observe that one word has not been uttered, which is tends to be overused in many places, is the word globalization. And the way in which changing international environment, the knitting together global marketplace and so on, may have both constrained policy and perhaps also contributed to some features of polarization. Let's open up. And there is a microphone. Please ask your question. Yes, sir. And kindly identify yourself, and we're limited in time, so please make the question sharp and brief.
Sure, thanks. My name is Hemant. I'm a financial consultant. Two issues we didn't discuss today. One is climate change. I think you briefly mentioned climate change. Can that cross across party lines? The other is marriage. I've seen a lot of Republicans cross the marriage on the other side, and the blacks on the religious ground crossing the other way. Is that an issue? And one more question. We didn't really discuss parliamentary systems.
I think we have to limit to one question. So that's a very good question. Are these cross-cutting issues that can create new coalitions?
Well, I mean, same-sex marriage, I think, has a momentum that's unstoppable, and it's really just cohort effects, which is to say age, which is the determining factor here. And so I suspect that there's not going to be a whole lot of mixing up of the party system due to same-sex marriage cases, but it's just a matter of time. And if anything, you see just Republicans trying to tamp down the issue. And then I mentioned climate change before, and it sort of depends. If we reach the stage where the sea levels are rising and we're losing cities, then there'll be a whole other set of issues that the political system's going to have to deal with.
Yes, please. Wait for the mic. And identify yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Laurie Zimmerman. Two short questions. The Supreme Court has allowed corporations and wealthy people to give any number of things during campaigns. Is that affecting it? That's one question. And the second one is our population in this country is now, the majority are not from Europe. Does a major factor in the polarization have to do with fear of not being the majority anymore?
Two questions, but very crisply put.
How about I take the Supreme Court one, and you take the Supreme Court. Like I said, here I'm going to have opinions without data. On Citizens United, I think, yes, that the effect of Citizens United is considerable when it comes to polarization. I shouldn't say the effect of Citizens United, it's the effect of the campaign finance system and the rise of outside groups. But that's because of what Nolan and I were saying before, which is that its relative strength as compared to the established institutions that used to be major electoral players, namely the political parties, right? So these, if I had to ask you, and I've done this with elites in the Republican Party, who's the leader of the Republican Party right now, right? Say John Boehner, that's not really John, Reince Priebus, that's not a name that, you know, most people know. Right? Because if you, when you say Karl Rove, you get closer, right? And or if you start talking about the Koch brothers. And so, and this is not a conspiracy point, this is a point about how the party is not an institution that can rival these outside groups when it comes to financing candidates. And the, where it is most pronounced is in the primaries. And this is something we don't have enough research on, is the effect of outside groups in primary elections, because 80% of the congressional races are going to be decided because they tilt so heavily for Democrats or Republicans. It doesn't make a difference how much money is spent in those races. It's really in the primary elections where you have extremely low turnout races where someone could put a thumb on the scales financially and make a difference.
On the diversity question, I think there's no doubt that a much more diverse society creates polarization. There's tons of social scientific evidence that suggests that diverse societies have a much more difficult time governing, providing public goods, and cooperating. And it's a very serious challenge the U.S. has to deal with. So that it's been politicized and is part of polarization and is reflected in the immigration debates is clear. It's not terribly surprising.
Not long ago, I asked a Democratic member of Congress from New York who was elected with 84% of the vote why he had thought to raise $1.2 million for his reelection. And he told me a story about how he had lost the vote in a high school presidency contest, and you quote, never know. Yes, back in the rear.
I seem to hear a consensus.
Please identify yourself.
Sion Bethel. I seem to hear a consensus that the best that we can expect is a chronic disability of the U.S. body politic. And is that the best that we can demand?
Well, I think both Nolan and I were arguing that polarization needs to be managed, and that it has to be, and so you need to focus on elite solutions to strengthen those institutions, which counteract the centripetal forces in American politics. And so I think we do have a prescription for the near future, which is that these structural problems which are creating polarization are not going to go away tomorrow, but that, you know, there are some interventions you can make to try to mitigate the effects.
Sir. Isn't perhaps presidential leadership a key missing ingredient to force his party to cross party lines? There's been some notable achievements in U.S. legislative history when that occurred. Teddy Roosevelt, as a Republican, forced his party, in effect, to join together and form the FDA. Lincoln with slavery.
The question's been well put. Let's hear what they say. Presidential leadership.
I think sometimes we over-romanticize presidential leadership on a variety of issues. I can't remember where the piece was. I think it was in the New Republic, taking to task Robert K. Rowe's description of the role of Lyndon Johnson in the Civil Rights Act. There was a real attempt to say, you know, Barack Obama is no Lyndon Johnson. If he were Lyndon Johnson, we wouldn't have these problems. I think the evidence, both historical and social scientific, suggests that we sometimes over-romanticize presidential leadership. Sometimes there's an appearance of leadership where there wasn't actually leadership. And sometimes it happens, but it's not something that we should be counting on.
It's also worth observing that the two greatest bursts of significant legislation, at least passed by Democratic presidents, Franklin Roosevelt in the early New Deal and Lyndon Johnson in the Great Society period, were passed with such overwhelming Democratic Party majorities that bipartisanship was not required. With lots of hands. Is there any student who's not asked a question? Yes.
Thank you. My name is Johan Garcia. I'm a student here at Hunter College, and my question is about women's representation in Congress. Do you think that by electing more women in Congress, can we combat polarization?
So part of it depends on the definitions of polarization. So if you use...
I thought you said part of it depends on the definition of women.
I don't think there's a lot of evidence that women are typically less ideological extreme. They may be less likely to engage in the extreme incivility that's characterized some of our politics, with some notable exceptions, perhaps Michelle Bachmann being that person.
What we're going to do now, because we've got about 10, 12 minutes, is to collect a series of questions, and then we'll come back at the end. Yes, ma'am. Well, just wait for the mic and kindly identify yourself.
What would be the impact on the two parties of the Pacific Trade Pact?
Okay. Yes.
I wondered, my name is Pat Emery, I wonder if there was any historic analog to the Tea Party, and what happened to that, and if that disappeared, what would that do to our politics, to our stability?
Yes.
We've heard about trends and movements, but I suggest we may have really a paradigm shift with a parallel in the Supreme Court with Clarence Thomas trying to reverse possibly 100 years of jurisprudence and some of our congressional representatives trying to reverse the administrative state or even some of the very foundations of our system.
Sir.
You know, I could give...
Oops. You've talked about the political dialogue being pushed over to the right. What would it take to move this dialogue closer to center?
When you talk about the decline and the possible strengthening of institutions that might promote a more solutions, what do you think about labor unions?
Yes. This young woman.
Hi. How does one combat the, I guess, willful ignorance about consensus among political scientists regarding the state of the polarization and kind of the causes and effects of it? And to what extent does journalism need to become more responsible in order to combat that?
We have time for, I think, for two more, and then we'll go to the panel and see if time remains. Someone on the aisle there, just there.
Hi, Ray Tillman. Your suggestion that political parties, if they were made stronger like they used to be, could curb the crazies in each one is a great idea. How do you do it?
And ma'am, wait for the mic, though.
Why the sudden bipartisanship with the budget and the debt ceiling bill?
Okay, well, we have enough questions that could occupy us for another few hours. Before turning to Nate and Nolan for their thoughts as we conclude, let me remind you, as Jonathan Fanton did, that we're gathering again on the 5th of March, in this room with two very distinguished students of Congress, Francis Lee of the University of Maryland and Sarah Binder of the Brookings Institution, who will take up the question of why Congress is finding it so difficult to legislate and govern. The question of polarization, but focused in on this core institution of American democracy, and you're all, of course, most welcome back for that. Gentlemen.
So these are a lot of great questions, so I probably won't have answers for all of them. So let me take a stab at a few. So the historical analogies of the Tea Party. So I think the closest historical analogy is something called the Townsendites of the New Deal. This was an effort to basically to have the old age insurance be provided on very generous terms during the New Deal. And it was a movement like the Tea Party, but it was on the left, and it basically imploded because of the divisions and conflicts within the movement. So I don't know whether that'll play out with the Tea Party. There is not one single Tea Party. It's a very fragmented group of people.
There are some questions about whether the Tea Party is a real thing or not, or it's just a marketing by otherwise conservative Republicans. So whether it'll play out in the same way, it's not clear. The question about journalism and how they report on politics, I think this is kind of a serious issue to be addressed. It's not just simply that they don't report on what political scientists say or do, that they over-romanticize things like presidential leadership, et cetera. But the real challenges to contemporary American journalism are very serious. The decline of newspapers, the decline of local papers. In fact, there's evidence tying the decline of local newspapers and their coverage of politicians to polarization. If I represent a district and I don't have a newspaper covering me, what's to hold me accountable to my constituents? And so there's any number of really serious challenges to journalism. And the question about the recent bipartisanship, I think it's important to note that when we say things are polarized and the parties don't cooperate, it's not that they never cooperate. But I do take exception to the notion that all of a sudden we've seen bipartisanship. We've seen bipartisanship in the shadow of a default of the public credit of the United States. That's just historically unprecedented. And so it's really great inflation to give Congress a B for passing a budget in the shadow of the default of the public credit. They deserve a D minus, and it's only slightly better than the F that they've gotten for the rest of the time.
Well, there are two remaining questions that I think Nolan didn't touch on. One was about parties, and the other was about labor unions. On labor unions, I think those are one of those institutions that now has such a clear political valence that it's seen as, you know, if you increase the power of labor unions, it's seen as a boost to the Democratic Party. And I don't see that. I mean, they're weakening in general, and I don't see how that would be sort of a bridge between the Democrats and Republicans. The second, on strengthening the parties, this is where the campaign finance issues come back. So public funding would be my preferred option in terms of giving, you know, $1 billion to each one of the political parties for an election season. But since that's not going to happen, I think the McCain-Feingold law actually does more harm than good. Now that Citizens United has kicked out one of the main provisions, which was restricting the ability of corporations to spend money, there's no reason why we should have these intense restrictions on the ability to give to political parties, because all it does is hobble their competitive position compared to the outside groups. And so if you can channel the money toward the more accountable institutions, I think it'll go a long way toward increasing their power vis-a-vis the outside groups.
I want to warmly thank Nate Persily and Nolan McCarty for a thoughtful, engaged, rigorous discussion of fundamental questions. Thank you so much.